So this is, for those of you who think you might be in the martial arts exhibit or some other lecture, this is our lecture, The American Challenge. And this is part three, The Best Democracy Money Can Buy. And I think we qualify solidly on this one. But at the beginning, since there is sort of a backdrop for all of this, the recent election, it's been quite a week again in the American democracy. I think I'll be saying that every time in here. It's very hard to summarize everything that happened. I won't even try. But as I'm thinking about people whose citizenship seems outstanding, I have to commend our state attorney general. Mr. Thompson, who decided to challenge the Ferguson, I'm sorry. Thank you. You are so on top of this. Can we crowdsource all the corrections? So, but that was a good one. And the case is being discussed now at the circuit court. Just this afternoon, so it's going to be very interesting to see where that goes and how it goes. In terms of my humor of the week, and there was much humor this week, happily we still have our senses of humor, I think the Bowling Green Memorial in New York City, the memorial for the massacre that never happened, and the motto, which could become a meme, is never remember, always forget. Okay. So that could be the new slogan for our public sphere communication experience here. But the thing that really captured my attention the most in this last week was this image involving an executive order affecting NGOs that provide abortion services, counseling, and so on. Do you notice anything? Do you notice a pattern in this picture? And a friend of mine from Sweden alerted me to the contrast between this picture and one that's been going around Sweden, accompanied by this picture in the last week. This is the Swedish. This is the Swedish Prime Minister and her advisors signing an environmental protection order that will bind all future governments of Sweden on carbon emissions. So those are the two most popular pictures in Sweden this week, and they are traveling as a pair. So tonight, I want to talk about three things, basically. What kind of government do we have? What's happened to American democracy? And how can it be fixed? Whew. Yeah, I can hear the thanks, because my intention here is to build some kind of a community and get a sense of what we can do. Small things matter in large numbers, and big things that will matter and be worth the energy that we invest in them. So what kind of a government? As you know, my name for it is DINO, democracy in name only. Others, including, to my great surprise, political science colleagues, have begun to question whether we still have a democracy. Political scientists are usually the last to get the memo on these things, but there's been some discussion about whether we now qualify as an oligarchy. Among political scientists having that discussion. Interestingly enough, recently, the Economist magazine intelligence unit, Economist is a business magazine, not a very radical business magazine by any stretch, has recently downgraded the US from a full to a flawed democracy based on these considerations. So now we're in the category that includes Italy, and they actually got Berlusconi before we got Trump, so there may be some trends to pay attention to here. Poland, and others that we might not immediately want to be compared with. So, the question is, why can't we handle the big questions, the big issues, the big problems of our time? And these are just a little smattering of them. There's certainly much more we could talk about, but some of these things seem to be persistent, chronic. So why can't we deal with these things? Well, maybe because the government doesn't work well, and that's what we're going to talk about tonight, is in what ways isn't it working well, and more importantly, why, and what can we as citizens do about that? But one possibility, and I'll just sort of shock you at the outset, I don't know how, you don't look very shockable, actually, as a group, but why don't we just call it corruption? Why don't we just say it's our government is thoroughly corrupted? I mean, back to the Gilded Age, the 1890s. The form of corruption is different, but the impact on whether the government represents the people and is capable of functioning to solve these problems is the same. So let's think about where we are today as we seem to be spiraling in a sea of cash, a sea of cash washing over our nation's capital. Turns out this is no secret, probably to you, and certainly not to the majority of Americans, who, as I said the first week, regard corruption as a super big problem, and large numbers of Americans share that concern. And look at this. Satisfaction with the way the nation is being governed. What was going on here?
Watergate.
So we have actually exceeded levels of dissatisfaction that registered during Watergate, the last great national scandal. But the difference between that national scandal and today's higher levels of dissatisfaction and sad levels of satisfaction is that this is systemic in ways that this was not. And indeed, Americans occasionally, not always, I mean, this varies with how the economy is doing. Has there been a terrorist attack lately? So what registers as the most important national problem varies. But dysfunctional government increasingly appears at or near the top of our list. But there's some confusion about why we have produced, developed such a dysfunctional government. Many Republicans see the problem as the government's too big to function, and let's get it down to the right size. Many Democrats say, well, it's business is actually wielding far too much power, and because government regulatory powers have been undermined, we need to actually ramp up regulations so that we better balance the power and influence of business in our lives. And then, of course, Republicans see that Democratic solution as the wrong solution, and the Democrats tend to see the Republican solution as the wrong explanation, and so on, and so it goes. But here's an interesting poll taken a few years ago. So satisfaction with the size, power, and influence of the government and major corporations. So if you look at all national adults in this poll by Gallup, you see that generally the majority is dissatisfied with the size and power of the federal government, and a similar majority is dissatisfied with the size and power of corporate influence in our politics. But the big split here happens when you take Republicans and Democrats and look at them separately. You see that Republicans are far more likely to be unhappy about the size of government. Democrats are far more likely to be unhappy about the power of big business. And interestingly enough, the independents sort of are unhappy about both. So maybe the independents have figured out that both of these things are problems. So hold that thought. Are both of these things problems? How are they problems? And how would we sort this out? Because that's one of the things I'm going to try to do this evening. But here's a possible model for all of that we're going to talk about in the next hour or so, which is that we talked a lot last time and the time before about inequality, growing inequality. I'll talk a little bit more about that tonight. But inequality is not just an economic and social problem. It's also a political problem because inequality divides us in terms of what we want to do in common. We don't live in the same realities anymore, so why would we share the same policy preferences or political goals? But more importantly, it buys access to government, which undermines democracy. So unequal access leads to less regulation of business and more tax benefits for those with preferred access, creating kind of a revolving door in which business influences government in lots of ways, lobbying, campaign finance, and then people from government end up leaving and going into business or lobbying careers and making a lot more money after they leave government. So there becomes a kind of symbiosis, not a very happy or functional symbiosis, between our elected officials and business communities brokered by lobbyists and the campaign finance process. So if you want to look at what's happening to former members of Congress, they end up going to work for lobbying firms or lobbying for particular clients or private organizations such as law firms or big businesses. So that pretty well takes care of all of them, right? So if you want to have a good career in business, get elected to Congress first. And then the rest of your future and financial well-being is well secured. So over the years that this regime has developed, it's perhaps not surprising that the wealth of even people in Congress has gone up. Because what candidates get backed? Well, there are people we know from law, from golf, from the business world, who we trust to spend our financial investments in them wisely, namely on our behalf. So if you look at 1984, all US representatives were, you know, much wealthier. This is wealth beyond houses. Okay, so most people have their wealth, if they have any, tied up in houses. This is wealth on top of houses. And you can see here's US families had an average surplus of 20,000. And here was the US House of Representatives. This was in the Reagan, the dawn of America years. But now, if you look more recently, in 2009, it's gone up that much. And look at that. US family wealth hasn't changed at all. And then it's a little bit different. The Republicans in Congress are slightly wealthier than the Democrats. But they're all generally looking pretty wealthy. So what happened to American democracy in these years? And as you recall, I've talked earlier about neoliberalism, what it means, when it arrived, what happened. Next week we're going to talk about it again in more depth because I think it's important to understand. But let's start with money in politics because that certainly seems to be the issue that most Americans are deeply concerned about, although Congress doesn't do anything about it and the Supreme Court has actually aggravated with its rulings in recent years. But I want to say before we go here, you know, they worry about political correctness on campuses a lot, they do. And one of the things that is made fun of is the trigger warning. So everybody is super sensitive about something, which makes it very hard for me as a teacher to not offend everybody. But one thing I've found that's helpful is to basically warn people who have sensitivities about particular things that their sensitivities might be aroused inflamed by what I'm going to say. What I notice, however, and this is strange, I'm guessing you're the crowd that is most sensitive to what I'm going to talk about here, more so than many of my students, it turns out, that I hope we are all sensitive to democracy. I hope that what I'm going to present to you does upset you in a way that motivates all of us to do things. I'm going to talk about what we can do at the end. Well, business influence over government has been growing since the 70s, since this big regime change from a kind of a Keynesian economy in which business and labor kind of balanced each other out in distributing economic outcomes, making policies that distributed economic outcomes more fairly to more people. But in recent years, the money spiral has escalated enormously. And the thing that kind of capped it in the recent period is something I'm sure you're all familiar with, the Supreme Court ruling in Citizens United. As you know, Citizens United is a kind of a political organization that has, among other things, targeted Hillary Clinton and other Democratic politicians, but Hillary Clinton seems to be their favorite target, and has made a number of movies, disparaging movies about Hillary Clinton, and ran one during the 2008 presidential campaign. And that was taken to court. Those who represented the Democratic Party and Hillary Clinton's interest, and a number of advocacy groups who feared that these kinds of films that were looking like campaign commercials were really detrimental to the conduct, the communication content, the quality of our election process, and more importantly, they were pouring a lot of money into our elections that didn't look like it was being properly vetted and regulated. Well, it turns out that the Supreme Court, in a very complex and very interesting 5-4 ruling, basically said, well, you know what, you can't stop this because money is free speech. Now, the court actually upheld the law requiring disclosure of sponsors and sources of the money. So Citizens United wasn't a complete disaster for those who wanted to pour a lot of money into politics behind a lot of propaganda for their favorite candidates and causes. And it created a problem for them that's a very interesting one I'm going to talk about in a second. The problem is basically if you're a CEO of a big corporation and you have stakeholders like investors, shareholders, customers who might be buying your products, maybe you don't want them to know that you're putting millions of dollars of both your personal money but also perhaps corporate money into very partisan and very inflammatory kinds of causes. So wouldn't it have been nice, wouldn't it have just made it so much simpler if the Supreme Court had said, oh, and by the way, we're also striking down the disclosure statutes for campaign money, but they didn't do that. So I'll show you how that was gotten around in just a minute. But let's stay with Citizen United for just a minute here. Citizen United is still in action. They helped lead the campaign on Hillary Clinton's Benghazi involvement. And today, if you go to the Citizen United site, you would think that they are a branch of the White House Communications Office. They claim that it was their help that got Trump elected. They're fully supporting the whole Trump agenda. So there is this kind of alliance. They're a piece of the Breitbarts and the Drudges and Citizens United and a number of these other so-called alt-right sites that have an agenda. And the agenda was sort of given the green light by the Supreme Court. Now, in addition to what it did and what it didn't do, in order to make a case for why all of this money was good for our politics, the court issued a kind of a legal parlor trick by saying that corporations are people. And since the Constitution protects all of us people, I hear you, I hear you. I've got something for you coming right up, actually. since corporations are people, then we can't limit their free speech, can we? Now, it turns out that different courts have handled this issue differently, and 100 years ago, corporations were prohibited from being involved in the election process in partisan ways. So this is kind of late breaking news on the Supreme Court front. But for you who I think were disagreeing about whether corporations are people, maybe this would be a kind of a litmus test for how how we might actually define people more clearly. So let's follow the money here. This is a sort of a simple introduction to campaign finance. Back in the good old days when there was plenty of money in politics, but it was kind of smallish and public, transparent, and regulated, we had political action committees that bundled money for candidates and campaigns, and the amounts that could be bundled, the amounts that could be given, amounts that could be given out, were all regulated and pretty small by today's money standards, really pretty small. And it was transparent. Reporting was done. Names were publicized. Then we got super PACs. Super PACs were kind of unleashed by Citizens United because there were no limits. Suddenly, you know, this superseded earlier limited corporate and private individual financing. And super PACs could use unlimited amount of monies. They could not coordinate their activities with campaigns directly, however that might work. And the donors were disclosed, okay? But they were really big, huge amounts of money. As I said, this presented a problem for a lot of wealthy people and corporations who didn't want their public images associated with some of the unpleasant things that they were doing with their money. So we ended up taking an interesting category of the organizational tax code, social welfare organizations, and Congress tweaked the tax code so that unlimited amounts of money could be given to these so-called dark money organizations, and they were dark money organizations because there was no public disclosure of sources. And now, if you think that's amazing, I'm not done yet. The tweaking of this tax code also allowed unlimited transfers of this dark money into super PACs. Yay! So now you can put as much as you want, you'll never be reported, and then your dark money organization can then give it to a super PAC, and the super PAC is forbidden to disclose where that money came from. So think about that. Super PACs are more set up to do the nitty-gritty of hiring film companies and buying commercial time on TV and all of those sorts of things. So let me show you how this works using one of my favorite fake news programs, which is...
Here to help me make my move to secrecy and obfuscation completely transparent, please welcome former general counsel to the McCain campaign and my personal lawyer, Mr. Trevor Potter. Trevor, nice to see you.
Okay, so who gives the dark money and who's got the dark money? It's almost all Republicans. Perhaps that comes as a shock and surprise to you, but it's almost all Republicans. And as we know, we don't know who pushed all of that money in there in most cases, but it's in there. And this is the spending. These organizations are far richer in terms of their bank accounts. This is the Karl Rove dark money organization. This is the Koch brothers, and so on. Does money matter? Yeah, it actually does. And here's what happens if you've got it, you win. If you don't have it, you tend to lose. So 91% of the winners spent more money. And that's kind of interacting with gerrymandering and safe districts and various other things. But money matters a lot. And even though some campaigns, Bernie Sanders, Barack Obama's first campaign and so on, had a lot of their funding from small donors, it's still pretty much parties, PACs, and large, rich individuals. For example, the 132 Americans who donated 60% of super PAC money. So 60% of that mountain of money came from, I don't even know what percentage of percent that is, but it's not a lot. It's a fraction of 1%. So what happened as these campaign money laundering laws and court rulings rolled forward is that billionaires continued to work the system. And in particular, after Citizens United, and it became clear that the disclosure requirements were still there, and that was very bad for some of these billionaires who wanted to be anonymous, or selectively so, is that they paid lawyers and lobbyists a lot of money to change the laws. And in fact, it worked. And that's how we ended up with these social welfare organizations doing politics. Because all you need is a claim that 51% of your activity is educational or some other social welfare function, and the other 49, you can do all the politics you want. Now, what kind of education might we be talking about? Well, how about educating other billionaires about political campaign finance reform? Yes, that counts. So a lot of the dark money organizations have seminars for billionaires to help them learn how to do this and what policies might advance these goals. And then, of course, the rest of the money can go to buying Congress, state legislators, school boards, drafting voter ID restriction laws, gerrymandering, and such. So what's happened as a result of this is that the Republican Party has been pulled very far to the right. I don't know if you noticed that. Very far to the right. But interestingly enough, it has angered many citizens on both the left and the right. This is going on for the Democrats too, by the way, just not as much. So it angered many citizens. So in a way, this brilliant scheme to take over Congress, state legislatures, school boards, and all kinds of the institutions of our democracy kind of backfired because it looked so bad. The optics were so bad for so many Americans that people who promised to drain the swamp get elected president. Now, draining the swamp is a term of art, I think we're talking here. It could be that we're simply replacing the creatures that inhabit the swamp. But the polarization point, I think, is quite remarkable. This is senators and representatives starting in the 1970s. Remember the timeline I gave you for the sort of neoliberal regime change was 70s, and then with Ronald Reagan's election, full bore into the 80s. But if you look at these are the ideological scores of senators and representatives based on their roll call votes as rated by left, right, or center. And what you find in the 70s is look at all this overlap. Look at in Republicans and Democrats, and look at the House. Lots of overlap. As we move into the 90s, there's a little bit here you could still kind of do business, compromise, bipartisan legislation, but it's shrinking, and in the House even more so. And by today, it's gone. It's totally gone in the House. And we see the glimmerings, in fact, of two Republicans joining the Democrats in the confirmation vote that took place today that required Mike Pence to actually come in and settle the issue. So how does this look in a network world where, you know, if members of Congress are voting with each other, well, you can find that out, of course. And all of these sort of gray, blurry areas are actually little lines connecting members of one party to members of another party in actual votes. Okay? So this is a kind of a more interesting representation because it actually shows that polarization matters, because when we had that overlapping ideology of the chart I just showed you, it turns out that we actually had overlapping voting. So people who were voting across party lines on particular pieces of legislation to make them happen. So here we are in the 70s. So there's still some sort of those blurry gray areas are little tiny lines connecting reds and blues. And then here we end up getting into the neoliberal area. This is 85, this is 87. Oh, look at that. They're kind of those gray zones are disappearing. And look, the dispersion. You get actual separation here. And now look into the 90s. Still a few things. Welfare reform probably accounts for things like this. And now we're moving into the 2000s, and wow. There's no voting across lines to speak of at all. So there's gridlock, and what many political scientists think caused it. And what's interesting, though, is if you step way back, so this is that was a look at an institution, Congress, but if you step way back and look at society and politics, as income inequality in the United States has grown to somewhat alarming levels for those who think Gini indices matter, and anything over a point is a 0 to 1 scale, and 1 is perfect inequality. It means I own everything and you all are kind of screwed. And this, you know, you end up with a few countries down here, but anything over 4 is beginning to alarm political scientists and those who study economies, even alarming to economists, because if inequality grows so extreme that people at the bottom don't have enough money to buy stuff, the consumer economy dies. So there's reason even for economists to be worrying about this level of inequality. But what's interesting to me is that you also get the polarized voting in Congress. Look at how polarized it is. That's perfect inequality. That's perfect polarization. So often people say, but what's the other side? I want you to hear the other side. Okay? This is the most intelligent version of the other side I could find. Good production values. And I'll tell you where it comes from in just a second.
I've been saving something special for you.
What is it?
In my many years in Washington, the most alarming development has been advertised under the soothing title of campaign finance reform. We Americans are disposed to think that the word reform is a synonym for improvement. But what is called campaign finance reform is nothing less than a frontal assault on the first, the most fundamental of our freedoms, the freedom to speak our minds and to participate in politics. This assault is always conducted stealthily by people who pretend that they only want to regulate money, not speech. They say they are only concerned about the quantity of money in politics. After the 2012 Romney and Obama campaign spent combined $2 billion, the usual cry was heard from reformers. They said there is too much money in politics. Forget the fact that Americans spend $2 billion every spring just on Easter candy, but you must remember this. People who say there is too much money in politics are necessarily saying three very sinister things. First, they are saying there is too much political speech. Second, they are saying that they know just the right amount of political speech. And third, they are saying that government should enforce the limits they want on the amount of political speech. That is, the government should regulate speech about the government. Over the last few decades, reformers have chipped away at the First Amendment guarantee of free speech. They've done it with various and sundry campaign finance laws, such as limiting the amount of money an individual can give to a candidate. But they're no longer satisfied with merely chipping away at the First Amendment. Now they want to take a sledgehammer to it. They admit that what they want to restrict free speech is incompatible with the Constitution. So for the first time in American history, reformers calling themselves progressives are proposing to change the First Amendment in order to empower Congress to decide the quantity, content, and timing of political speech.
Every campaign
and who would benefit from the speech restricting rules Congress would write?
Has been
well,
or
we
will
know
be
this.
Written by incumbent
every campaign finance law that ever
is,
has existed or ever will exist has
will
been or will be written by incumbent legislators.
Incumbents have
that
enormous
is,
electoral
all
advantage.
All laws regulating campaigns will favor the re-election of incumbents.
Catalog of favors
incumbents have enormous
so
electoral advantages
hence,
stemming from their composites of office,
do not need
name
to spend
recognition,
as much money
a catalog
as their
of favors done for constituents,
hence,
and so on.
Incumbents write laws making
incumbents generally do not need to spend as much money
those
as their challengers must spend.
How much money
hence,
we can contribute
incumbents
to
write laws making fundraising
spend
more
on
difficult.
Campaigns.
Always those who advocate restricting
thing.
How much money
say,
we can
we
contribute to candidates
money.
Or
and
how
money
much money candidates
speech.
Can spend on campaigns,
see how silly
always
this
say the same
is.
Thing.
Consider the following.
They say we are only
the
restricting
New York Times
money, and money is not
speech. But money is not speech.
To see
and
how
therefore
silly
the
this
spending
distinction
of money
is, consider the following.
Restricted without
the New York Times
of
constantly
speech.
Says that
but
money is not speech,
suppose
and
conservatives
therefore the spending
control
of money can be
to the New York
restricted
Times.
Without
restricting freedom of speech. We, of course, would
of
never
speech.
Restrict the freedom
but
of the Times to
suppose
practice
conservatives
journalism. Heaven
controlled
forbid.
Congress and said to the New York
we
Times,
we are only going to restrict the amount
of
money
the
Times
the freedom
can
spend of the Times
to
practice
news and
journalism.
Its
heaven forbid.
The amount it can spend on journalists,
going to restrict
paper,
the amount of money
ink,
the Times can spend
printing
on
presses,
gathering
delivery
the
trucks,
and distributing
advertisements, and so on.
The amount it can spend on journalists,
do you think
journalists,
the New York Times would
paper,
be content with this?
Ink,
could the Times say, that's
trucks,
fine, because you are only
so
regulating
on.
Our right to spend
do you
money,
think the
not
New York
our
Times
right
would
to speak?
Be content with this?
No.
Could the
Times,
Times
would
that's
strenuously
fine,
object.
Because you are only
it would say,
our right
money
to spend
is indispensable
money, right
for making
speak.
Our speech effective.
No.
That
the
is
Times
true,
would
and not
object.
Just for the Times.
It would say,
without ample money, no congressional candidate
effective.
Can speak to an entire congressional district,
and not just for
and
the
no
Times.
Senate candidate
without
can communicate to
money,
an entire
no
state,
congressional candidate
and no presidential
an
candidate can make
district.
His or her case
and
to
no
our
Senate
continental
can
nation.
Communicate to an entire state.
Contributing to candidates
and
is
no
one of the most common forms of political participation.
To our
so restricting campaign contributions reduces participation.
Common forms
the
of political participation.
Constitutional way
so
to reduce the amount of money invested in politics is to reduce the role of politics in the distribution of money. If government were not so big,
politics,
if it were not so busy allocating wealth and opportunity
the
to the politically
money,
well-connected, then
so
politics would be less important
so
in our lives and less money would be spent on it. So, the next time someone says we should make government even bigger by giving it the power to regulate speech, tell that person that what we really need is more speech advocating less government. I'm George Will for Prager University.
Anybody heard of Prager University? Well, it turns out it's a website and a YouTube channel, but very well funded. It's sort of like
about 3 months ago, my millionaire boss hold.
That's what it pretends to combat, corruption.
So it's a little bit like Glenn Beck University, only it's run by another former talk show host named Prager, And the money for Prager University and these kinds of pitches for let's allow more free speech to get a smaller government is paid for by two of America's biggest fracking billionaires. And you can imagine why they don't like big government either. So that's the sort of essence of the problem. But there are other problems that you could ornament around that in thinking about why democracy seems to be having a bad time in America these days. And I'm going to mention a few of them in a few minutes. But what I'd like to do is think about what else is going on as a result of this one massive force. Okay? There are other forces at work, so I'm not pointing to this as the only one. But, well, popular representation is broken. It turns out that some people have more free speech than others because some people are richer than others and they don't distribute perfectly across all the political spectrum or all the issues we might want to have someone speaking for. Like poor kids who don't get enough to eat don't have unlimited amounts of money to raise their voices as high as fracking billionaires might, for example. But then elected officials are distracted. This is a pretty big part of the elected official's job, raising this money. So how much time do they spend on the people's business and how much do they spend on their careers raising this money every day? And then it's not just raising money, but at some point, people get tired of being asked for money all the time. Do you get that, you know, every time that phone rings at home and there's a pause before somebody kicks in and wishes you well and then asks for money? People get tired of it. And so what do you do? Well, if you're a little NGO asking people on the phone for money, there's not much you can do. But if you're a member of Congress on a committee that can draft and hold hearings about legislation that affects industries regulated or affected by that committee, you can do lots of things. You can call the lobbyists for these industries and say, you know, I'd really like to bring that bill up, but we're just so busy. I just don't see any way of getting it in this session. Oh, really? Yeah, I mean, you know, talk to my staff people, you know, maybe there's something we can do. And that's the signal that if you tell my staff people you're going to make a big campaign contribution to me, they will move your bill up in the queue. That's extortion. Or suppose you have been giving a very favorable regulatory statute to an industrial sector, but the public doesn't like it, right? You can have this phone call. Or your staff, it's usually the staff. You know, the people are really angry about this tax break for ethanol going into automobiles. It doesn't make sense to a lot of people. We might have to take it back. No, don't do that. Well, would a campaign contribution help? It might. It might. I'll have to talk to the other people on the committee, but actually if you would be so kind, we might see what we can do to not take back your benefit. So either giving out or taking back these benefits. And then quality officials, not surprisingly, can't live in this system. It's too unpleasant. It recruits the corruptible and drives away the pure of heart. As a result of all this, people have gotten fed up with government, and so we get renegade candidates and now a president. And as a result of all of this, since politicians can't tell the public what's really going on in government or why this legislation got passed or that didn't and why so many things that so many people care about never get attention, the communication process is dizzying. It is mind-numbingly opaque or kind of stupefyingly simple. So let's look at representation and what happened there. And here's another, this is political science in action, and rather than me show you a bunch of charts, I'm going to let people who have better animation skills than I do show you the charts. But this is why we don't have a democracy, because at the very core of democracy, it's one person, one vote, one representative point. And
for the last few years, I've had this sense that everything I learned as a kid about how America's government works is completely wrong. But I had no idea how bad things actually were until I saw this one graph. Researchers at Princeton University looked at more than 20 years worth of data to answer a pretty simple question: does the government represent the people? Now, this is what they found. This axis here represents public support for any given idea. On the left, at 0%, are ideas that not a single American wants. On the right, at 100%, are ideas that everyone supports. This axis represents the likelihood of Congress passing a law that reflects any of these ideas, from a 0 to a 100% chance. On this graph, an ideal republic would look like this. If 50% of the public supports an idea, there's a 50% chance of it becoming law. If 80% of us support something, there's an 80% chance. You get the idea. Now, most Americans would probably agree that, with a few exceptions, we should be as close to this ideal as possible. Unfortunately, the way America actually works doesn't even come close. Take an idea that nobody supports, literally nobody, and it has about a 30% chance of becoming federal law. Now, take an incredibly popular idea, the most popular idea this country has ever seen, and there's also about a 30% chance of it becoming law. This means that the number of American voters for or against any idea has no impact on the likelihood that Congress will make it law. Put another way, and I'm just going to quote the Princeton study directly here, the preferences of the average American appear to have only a minuscule, near zero, statistically non-significant impact upon public policy. So if you've ever felt like your opinion doesn't matter and that the government doesn't really care what you think, well, you're right. But there's a catch. This flat line only accounts for the bottom 90% of income earners in America. Economic elites, business interests, people who can afford lobbyists, they get their own line. Look at how much closer their line is to the ideal. When they want something, the government is much more likely to do it. And when they don't, they have the power to completely block it from happening, no matter how much the rest of the country supports it. They get what they want, and guess who ends up paying for it? We pay for it with the most expensive healthcare in the world. We pay for it with a tax code that's a complete mess. We pay for it with internet that's slower and more expensive, with wasteful spending, a floundering education system, a catastrophic drug war, and 1 in 5 American children born into poverty. Almost every major issue we face as a nation can be traced back to this graph. How does this happen? Well, just follow the money. Right now, it's perfectly legal to buy political influence in America. Here's how it works. Let's say a big bank wants a law that would force taxpayers to bail them out again if they repeat the exact same reckless behavior that crashed the global economy in 2008. Not exactly the most popular idea with the public, and Congress knows that. That should be the end of it. But that's where the money comes in. It's perfectly legal for our bank to hire a team of lobbyists whose entire job is to make sure that the government gives the bank what it wants. Then, those lobbyists can track down members of Congress who regulate banks and help raise a ton of money for their re-election campaigns. It's perfectly legal for those lobbyists to offer those same politicians million-dollar jobs at their lobbying firm. Then, those lobbyists can literally write the language of this new bailout law themselves and hand it off to the politician they just buttered up with campaign money and lucrative job offers. And it's perfectly legal for those politicians to take the lobbyist-written language and sneak it through Congress at the last second. So now you've got a law that greatly benefits the banks, and the whole process can start over. This is how a bill becomes a law. A special interest hires some lobbyists, those lobbyists collect campaign contributions, offer jobs, and then write the laws that Congress then passes to help those same special interests. This happens every day on every single issue with politicians of both parties. In the last 5 years alone, the 200 most politically active companies in the United States spent $5.8 billion influencing your government. Those same companies got $4.4 trillion in taxpayer support. And that's trillion, with a T. And that's just the top 200 companies. Never mind every other special interest, every union, every trade association, and every billionaire. Every single one of them can use their money to buy political influence. You know, there's this idea out there that this only became a problem after the Supreme Court Citizens United decision in 2010. But the data goes back almost 40 years, and the results are clear. Corruption is legal in America. And as long as it is, anyone who can spend money to buy political influence will. The solution here isn't rocket science. Make corruption illegal. We already know Congress won't do it. I mean, one look at this chart will tell you that. What we need is a plan that lets us go around Congress and do what the American people do best. Fix this mess ourselves. Well, good news. We have that plan and it's already working. Now that we've got the problem covered, let us show you how to be part of the solution.
So this is just one of many organizations that's taking positive action that makes sense if you want to solve this problem. And I'll mention them again in a few minutes. So that's a pretty good investment, isn't it? A few billion for a few trillion. Who wouldn't make that investment? It's better than investing in new equipment or hiring different work. I mean, it's the best possible investment you could make for your company. And if your company is mandated to make profits, of course you would invest in government first. And they do. But this doesn't make Americans happy. This is one of the areas where Americans are not represented, where that flat line of representation is among the most pronounced. The role of money, is it too much? 84% say yes, and that it should be limited, but it's not. And it won't be until citizens join together to take action to pass anti-corruption laws. But we can do it, and I'll talk a little bit in a minute about how. So who does get representation? Well, it's pretty clear. So I'm going to go through quickly. But these kinds of investments are, you know, if you break them down to the granular level of how many trillions or billions go into how many trillions, or how many millions convert into what level of return. So Whirlpool invested just a couple of million to get energy tax credits for its appliances. That totaled $120 million. That's an amazingly good investment. We have to credit the executives at Whirlpool, I think, for making that kind of money for their shareholders. Question is, should we let that happen? That's a different question. So who's being represented? Well, the rich. And I told you last time that income inequality and the chart for wealth inequality looks much the same as this. You go back to 1929 levels, and we are there, and this was our little blip in 2007, but it has gone back up since this chart, the data in this chart were produced. Corporate profits, look at this. Look at this, this is the 40s, 50s, and into the 60s, the Keynesian era, in which corporations were making money and people were still very rich. But now we see these extraordinary rates of corporate profit, and here's again the financial meltdown of 2008, but it's gone back up to where it was before. And taxes. Our president says taxes are too high. Pretty much everybody in Washington is paid to say our taxes are too high. They have to pass that litmus test if they want to get money, many of them. And if you think about this, I think I mentioned last week that Denmark is almost always the happiest country. How can they be happy? Look at the tax rates they're paying. Unbelievable. And what's wrong with them? How can they be happy? And here we are keeping company with Korea, Chile, Mexico, and Switzerland. So representation is the first casualty of this system. But really, the time that our public servants can spend on public business is severely diminished by this system. So here's Fritz Hollings, who retired from the Senate some years ago. And this is kind of, the numbers are higher now, but the logic is still the same. So last time he ran for the Senate, he had to raise this much money, which at that point was that much a week that he had to rake in. It would be more than this today, or when he said this. Every working hour the senator has his or her mind on fundraising. No time for constituents, no time for the needs of the country, only time for the needs of the campaign. So that's a huge distraction. And then we come to this unpleasant reality of the process that I explained a few minutes ago, is that if you contact people who will be affected by the legislation passing through the committee that you chair, or bills that, as Speaker of the House, you can bring up or not, and say, we might not be able to do this, or we might have to take this away from you, you tend to get a cash response. So the extortion racket kind of goes like this. This one is called the toll booth. They even have a name for it. Is you set up a toll booth on your committee. And anyone who wants legislation or not to have legislation withdrawn has to pass the toll booth in order for it to happen. So quality officials are leaving politics. It's been going on for years, long before Citizen United, as that earlier video suggested. Olympia Snow left, one of the great sort of central players in the Republican Party. She couldn't take it anymore, but dozens and dozens and dozens of people who really want to have a government that isn't for sale have simply left because they can't defeat the system from within. The result, of course, is tremendous loss of public trust. And you see polls like this echoing some of the ones that I showed earlier this evening. And almost everybody, including bipartisan majorities, believe that the wealthy have a much more equal chance to influence the election process than we do, than ordinary citizens do. So all of this brings us to a fascinating topic called reality. What is it? What do you think? Do we have it still? Is the public sphere, the national political conversation, has it spiraled insanely out of control? This has been a long process. We hear about fake news today, but I've been watching this process for 20, 30 years. As issues are bought and taken out of circulation, politicians have to say something, and so they kind of make it up. And the news wants to report to the people what their elected officials are saying, and so they report the stuff that politicians kind of made up. So what's fake news? And did it just happen? Or has it become so absurd that we finally go, oh my God, somebody needs to stop this? So this is where I'm going to add some of the things around money that are also causing our institutional failure. So it's not all about money. The breakup of trusted institutions like the public schools, and you know who just got approved today to run our national public education. So the fragmentation of public schools means that we have fewer and fewer and fewer shared social experiences as a people. Common texts, common understandings. So as those shared experiences disappear because the schools are being broken up, because super rich people like to live in gated communities because they feel safer there and don't mix with people or buy that ultra penthouse section of the luxury cruise ship that I showed you the first week, all of this fragmentation of our common institutional bonds is beginning to erode authorities. Authorities who could probably be trusted to give us good information, quality information. I mean, I've noticed that in my own teaching. When I started teaching in 1974, can you believe that? 1974, I mean, we had great exchanges in class, but when I sort of made some bullet points, students tended to write them down. Imagine that. Today, when I try to make some points, students go, "Ah, what does he know? Ah, I know stuff that, you know, he's not talking about, so he's not presenting the other side." Well, I have a problem if I know the other side isn't true. I have trouble presenting that just to present another side. But that's the world we live in, because everybody knows their own truth, and they want to hear it from authorities. And so we're in this world of saying whatever and believing whatever. There's little public leadership on all of these tough issues that we've been talking about in here. And official communication ends up being mostly spin and PR. It's sort of, you know, you get tired of it. And finally, people decide they can find better sources than their teachers, their elected officials, their newspapers. They can go to trusted social networks or websites that engage them fully emotionally, like Breitbart or Drudge or Citizens United, and find truth there. So, what if campaign commercials looked more like this?
Hi, I'm Gil Fulbright. The people who run my campaign, they've made this commercial, and I'm in it. This campaign, it's not about me. It's about crafting a version of me that'll appeal to you. A version that visits random work sites with paid actors pointing at things. A version of me that doesn't find old people loathsome or pointless. Has a conventionally attractive yet curiously still family. Listening to my constituents, legislating, these are things I don't do. What I do is spend about 70% of my time raising funds for re-election. I'd do anything to stay in office. My name's Gil Fulbright, but hell, I'll change my name to Phil Goldbright or Bill Fulbright or fill up my mouth with farts. These are the things that are important to me. And these are the fine people that finance my campaign. Now, in order to do these things, I have to stay in office. And to stay in office, I have to keep these guys happy. Now, if any of these things make these guys unhappy, well, my hands are tied. So come November, the choice is clear. Do you want another spineless mouthpiece for special interest and lobbyists? Or a spineless mouthpiece for special interest and lobbyists? I'm Philip, a mouth with farts, and I approve this message.
So we live in this world with fragmented authority, don't know who to trust, don't trust politicians, surely, increasingly since they bring us the words, the press brings us words from politicians. We don't trust the press. They're neck and neck now as being untrustworthy. So with all, and then anger and confusion because people are understandably upset. This is upsetting at some level for most people. And back in the good old days of the 1970s, where there were three, does anybody remember, there were three national nightly newscasts, and they all kind of had the same news, but delivered by A somber and professional anchor, or a friendly and caring anchor who is basically telling, you know, the version of the story that you most like to hear. But the age of the captive public that we're calling it in political science these days, that hears much the same news from credible sources in a time when politicians were still trusted and there was bipartisan overlap getting some of the jobs done, not all, I'm not trying to make this into a fairy tale, but that's gone. That age is clearly gone, and now we've got proliferation of media channels. I mean, so many out there with such large audiences that it's quite amazing. And they're selling information. They're selling information, and in a very competitive environment, they have to make it attractive so people come back and click through and stay there while the ads are running on them. So why did the media sell us Trump? Well, people were watching because it was a spectacle and no one thought it possible. And now some media are beginning to think, gee, did we get this guy elected? Yeah, they did. They did. So as authority shifts away from institutions to our social networks, we are now living in an information system that basically allows people to believe what they want. I call it the democratization of truth. There are a lot of things I think should be democratized, but truth? Do we want to let people vote on climate change? We are, but we do. It's happening. So indeed, the democratization of truth is maybe one of the things we might want to withhold democracy from, just a little bit. So without these reality anchors, authorities and institutions, discourse becomes plastic. So we hear that Barack Obama is a communist. We hear that, oh no, he's a fascist. Which is he? Communist, fascist, maybe he's both. So here's Glenn Beck before he went to form Glenn Beck University, explaining that people like Obama are both a communist and a fascist. Just like Pavlovian conditioning. It's a wonderful video clip that I don't have time to show you, but check it out. It's quite amusing. Science has become just another ism. Just another way of knowing. It's kind of annoying to people like me who are scientists. But it's a reality, and we see it blatantly on display in areas like climate change, where those who deny it get into the news and get elected to office in large numbers. So does anybody really care that the president is lying? Well, of course, some do. But in the dizzying propaganda world that we are living in, we just don't need to worry about the facts anymore. And that's kind of a relief, right? Oh. So it's not fake news, it's just alternative facts. And you might recall this one. About, you know, Trump seems to be concerned about the size of things, I don't know. Including his inaugural crowd, which the photos seem to pretty clearly suggest wasn't as big as Obama's. And so Chuck Todd on Meet the Press challenged Kellyanne Conway about this claim, because Spicer went out and said this, period. And you know, Kellyanne, don't be so dramatic. You know, he just gave alternative facts, that's all. But this isn't new. This is not new. This happened, I remember clearly that it happened after the Bush administration started the war in Iraq, based on false claims that they knew to be false about weapons of mass destruction. Okay? That's an alternative fact. And it was promoted and picked up by the media and by large numbers of people in Congress. And so we ended up going to war on alternative facts. and that war is still haunting us today, massively. So this is not new. So this is that moment in the program where I've probably taken you to the brink of despair, and now let's walk back from there. Okay, I probably pushed the limits and I apologize for that, but let's end on a cheery set of notes. Yes, so you remember this feature. We don't do that. We do this. And tonight, what we're gonna do is think about what we can do. Okay, so we're gonna begin looking at serious political actions we can take. Assuming you buy my argument that we've got a problem. So can our democracy be fixed? Here's my favorite solution right off out of the gate, is that we simply brand the members of Congress like race car drivers with the patches of their sponsors, okay? So this would help a lot. But there are some other steps too, assuming that that one might be tricky. We can join the anti-corruption movement of the sort that that video promoted. We can join a movement for a new election system so that the majority that actually voted for the other candidate might get their candidate in office. And a proportional representation system in the national and state legislatures, so we would create incentives for new parties that could actually get into power and form coalitions the way they do in almost every other country that's a democracy. We could actually restore regulatory powers that have been stripped from the Securities and Exchange Commission, and I'll tell you why Securities and Exchange Commission are important to democracy in a minute, but also the Federal Election Commission, which is completely dysfunctional and has been for some time, intentionally so. And we could ramp up our existing national discussion of inequality in ways I'm going to talk about briefly. And we can amend the Constitution. Won't that be fun? But if we're going to get the money out of politics, it's the last and only hope. And it's been done before. And it needs to be done again. So buckle up and go online and learn a little bit about credible groups that are beginning to organize constitutional amendment campaigns around the country. And then take personal actions, and I'll talk about a couple of examples that make sense to me. So the anti-corruption movement, here's one door into it. There are other doors, but this one is sponsored by people like Lawrence Lessig, whom I respect, who's kind of a bipartisan and a fine legal mind. Trevor Potter, whom you met on Stephen Colbert's show just a few minutes ago. And there are anti-corruption acts now being passed around the country. And they can become models for the national level, or more likely, since it won't get national approval through Congress, models for the constitutional amendment. So that's very important stuff, and it's happening. So please don't despair. This is happening. Restoring the power of regulatory agencies. This is the embattled chairperson of the Federal Election Commission who says that it's worse than dysfunctional. It's not just dysfunctional, it's worse, because they don't like each other, they fight, they don't do anything, they can't do anything. It's been completely politicized. The thing that the Securities and Exchange Commission could do is it could end the dark money. It could say that shareholders have a right and customers have a right to know what this company is doing politically, period. And that would become part of the regulatory disclosure of corporate America. But it's not. But it could be. So that's something that you could get interested in and see how, I mean, there are people doing advocacy for this. We need a new election system. It's not that complicated. It's politically difficult. But constitutional amendment, suddenly everything below the Constitution, that includes the Supreme Court, would have to obey it. So why not get serious about amending our sacred Constitution? We hear enough about it every day. Surely we could take control of it and put a different election system in place. And then the discussion about inequality, which is underway, could be ramped up. So we're talking about wealth and power and not just helping those at the bottom a little bit more. That's nice, it's good, but it's not enough. So let's, when we think about inequality, think about power and democracy as being totally wrapped up in our inequality problem. And then amending the Constitution. These folks are out there demonstrating to amend the Constitution. So what can we do personally? So those are some things we can do collectively. And then some of the personal things involve collective engagement, of course. We can march, as many of us did. AVAZ, which is a kind of a move-on type organization based primarily in Europe, but actually launched a Dear Mr. Trump letter that 5 million people signed in a matter of days and made the news in all these news organizations around the world. But there are some more challenging actions. I'm going to wrap on this and take some questions. We can join actions, but I would encourage us to think about what actions we join. I mean, my recommendation and what I'm doing is to think about actions that put this picture in play, that think of the environment as the biggest context in which everything else operates, and society as the next biggest context in which everything operates, government being responsive to environment and society, and the economy serves all of that within the limits and the welfare of these other spheres. So we should get involved in things that I think advance this kind of a holistic way of thinking about who we are on this planet together, living in different countries and in different political systems, and do things that have a chance to expand in scale and connect a lot of dots. Right now, the left in particular is terribly fragmented and really not well organized. So let's stop it. One of the things we're doing on campus is trying to gather all the scattered student organizations that are doing really good work, but are few in number and not connected well to each other. And we're thinking of developing a sustainability action network at our center that will allow students to come in and find partners that cross these issue silos. So environmental groups can find democracy groups, and they can find economy groups and begin to think together about activities and learning experiences that can be spread through the whole campus, such as the teach-in we had in the spring that drew 300 students and community members lined up out the door of the Walker Ames room upstairs. So those things are doable, and I'm sure you can all find your own versions of those things, but I encourage you to, you know, use your time and energy wisely in maximizing what you want to get out of your action. So, and every day, this is what we can do. Every day. Sometimes it takes courage to do this. Sometimes it's easy, but sometimes it takes courage. And I encourage all of us to speak up, admit that we may not know everything, or even be sure what a good democracy would really look like, since it's been so long since we had one. But engage in searching, fact-oriented discussions about our values with each other. So with that, I say thank you very much. And those who need to go may do so, and those who would like to ask questions, stay. Thank you. Okay, hi.
I'd like to start with a question on the dysfunction you talked about in government. You talk mostly about the federal level. Do you see as much chaos at the state levels, in particular, even our state?
It sort of depends on what state you're in. Louisiana looks really dysfunctional. Washington State looks a little bit more functional, but because of the political choices that have been made, no income tax, among others, we can't do a lot of things. I mean, we can't provide affordable college education for our children. I mean, that's I think tragic. So if you go in and look at different issue areas, you'll find that we're more or less functional, I think. Okay, we have just, you can just run it. Oh, okay. We'll get to you next.
Can you talk some more about the influence of talk radio on all of this problem, like Rush Limbaugh and company?
Well, it's part of the ever fragmenting, it's sort of like the Big Bang of the media verse. And now there's so many little spheres with their own realities operating in them. So Rush Limbaugh has a pretty big following. But I remember years ago I had a neighbor who was listening to Rush Limbaugh tell him that he couldn't get away without paying taxes. And I thought, Dave, this isn't going to work well for you. And he said, no, I've researched the whole thing. And then he found other sources that encouraged him to stop paying taxes because it was illegal to actually force us to pay taxes. And about 6 months later, two guys in black suits showed up at his door from the IRS and explained what would happen to him if he stopped paying taxes. And now he's a dutiful taxpayer. But not everybody ends up running into realities that are that certain when they listen to these various information sources coming from all angles. So yeah, I mean, this fake news business is a long path. Yeah. So it's not just this year. So I think this part, yes.
I understood that the corporations became people way back in 1886 with the Santa Clara versus Southern Pacific Railroad case. And that before that, the federal government had no control over them whatsoever. And after that, all of the federal corporate law was made. And because of that, the law was all based on the corporations are people concept, and without corporations being people, that law will have no basis. Would you comment on that?
I mean, the Supreme Court invents realities. That's what lawyers do, right? And sometimes, if they get politicians to agree with them, you end up inventing realities that don't work well for anybody. But much less most of us. So this the idea that we are grounding any of this in some divinely right document such as the Constitution. I mean, the Constitution is a political football and has been treated better and worse as such over the years. And it's not being treated well at all today. In my humble opinion, but what do I know? Yes?
My question is about opening up the Constitution, and I've heard fragments about this, so I'm not quite sure, but I think I remember that a certain number of states, you only need a certain number of states in order to change something in the Constitution,
right,
to add or subtract an amendment. And at this point, the Republicans hold close to or enough state legislatures that they could change the Constitution. And I am wondering why this group thinks that that would be changed in a way that would be beneficial to all Americans or beneficial to more of the same.
It's a good question. On the other hand, what's the alternative? And so at some point, when things have been changed in the Constitution, it has often been the result of either catastrophic national upheaval that shook everything up, like the Civil War, or political compromise, like went into the Bill of Rights, or social movements of the sort that got women the vote. And so I think that just hoping that a few people will create a constitutional convention that will produce the best outcome, because there are certainly outcomes that we wouldn't be happy with, is going to take a social movement. I mean, but you all look like a really energetic bunch. You can do this. We can do this. I mean, it takes commitment, but it takes agreement on what matters. And that's one of the things that I see really, really lacking is what would we like to do? Well, I'd like to make this better. I'd like to change that. I would like to do this other thing. And we all have our issues and our pet causes. Meanwhile, democracy is not going so well. So I think that there might be time to have a national conversation about what really matters, what are the top priorities, what kind of a package of ideas do we want to share and spread in the world, and then what kind of action is going to hold elected officials accountable for doing these things. And the press. I mean, the press, I think, got a wake-up call after sort of delivering us Trump on a daily basis for the whole campaign, because it was so incredibly profitable for these struggling news organizations. I've noticed somewhat of a change of tone in the New York Times and the Washington Post. I mean, pointing out that Trump is lying. Who knew that the press would ever do that? So there are these little glimmerings. And then at some point we'll run up there.
Are there any lessons that we can take from the South Dakota effort to get corruption out of their government?
Yeah, I mean, I think that they're one of the states that has passed a version of the anti-corruption law. So there, but there are cities, there are states, and so the answer is, you know, you all are researchers by the fact that you have access to Google. Use it wisely. Don't believe everything you find there, but you can find a lot of documentation on what has been done. I mean, you can cut to the chase and go to the Represent Us website, and they'll tell you all the places that have passed anti-corruption laws and what those laws look like. So I think it's an important thing to do, because it sends a signal. It sends several signals. It suggests that we know this isn't a democracy really, that it's corrupted, why it's corrupted, and what we'd like to do about it. I mean, I think those are good signals to be sending. Whether this law is the perfect one or that law is the perfect one, I can't really say.
If I look around this room, I see mostly my contemporaries. If I think of the process that you describe, it's going to take a long time. And what is happening in education in the kindergarten on up? Basically, civics is sort of gone as a subject. And by the time we get students, they really don't understand much about how the country functions. Your thoughts on how to get this into grade school?
Well, how about a movement to actually restore public education as the common fabric of this democracy? I mean, that was a Jeffersonian ideal. I mean, this is in the charter. The chartering ideas of our country are public education that is affordable and has common threads running through it. So I think that, I mean, speaking personally, I know that when our son was ready to head off to high school, we had a soul-searching moment about, you know, do we sort of go broke and put him in a private school, and, you know, as opposed to a scary public school that might not give him the very best of everything. And we made a political commitment to stay in public schools, and I don't know how you feel, Oliver, but I'm guessing it didn't damage you too much. Actually, he's an undergraduate here at University of Washington today on the dean's list, who survived public schools in Seattle. So, and I know you're going to kill me after for that. I'm very sorry. Okay, two more questions. So, yes?
Yeah, I'm interested your own comments, and I think a lot of us, we've gone through in the last 2 weeks some incredible demonstrations in the country. And nobody saw the power of this women's march taking a place. I mean, the organizers did, but just how much was accomplished and was brought forward to the House of Congress even. Mm-hmm. And then the immigrants issues in the state of Washington, but a lot of other places. And how spontaneous some of those actions were in various airports, and how we gave support to people in South Asia that were already in this country, and the Middle East that were already in this country. So to me, we need to study the power of these really spontaneous movements and how dissatisfied people are, and what can we do to plug in. Like, for example, you mentioned education. We have one of those situations in the House and Senate in the state of Washington, where public education is continually now, we have a real decision to make, and it's one of those places where we can really start to move with other people. And as far as I'm concerned, I was very impressed with what has happened in the country in relation to how people really didn't plan all of this, but there was enough planning where it really took, it gave people a lot of hope, and I think there's a lot more activism just from that. So I'd like to hear your comments about that, please.
Yeah, I think it's very hopeful. I have two concerns. One is that we are all going to fall victim to protest fatigue. And that's a real concern, and because there are going to be so many things happening. I mean, the you know, travel ban is just for starters, really. So how do we manage all the stuff that's going to happen is one thing that I think we need to do a reality check on. But the second thing is, while we're busy protesting Trump and all of the things that the Trump administration may be doing, are we in danger of not figuring out what we would like this democracy to become post-Trump, right? And to me, post-Trump isn't going to be much better. I mean, it might be less stupid, but it may not be much better in terms of the quality of governance if we don't think about what's our goals and what are the ideas. I mean, that's why I've spent a lot of time thinking about what would the ideal political system on this planet look like for more people? And to me, that's my values. I will engage in a march here or a march there, but everything I do from here on is going to be filtered by what I think these higher values need to look like. Environment, yes. Social control of the economy and government, yes. And an economy that serves all of the above. To me, that's what I want to start organizing my politics around. And I invite you all to join in thinking about how that would work. In the meantime, a little sense of humor doesn't hurt. So, yes?
I kind of agree with the last speaker back there about Trump creating a mass movement in this country that doesn't seem to have any particular direction. Would it not be a good idea for somebody like a university here to bring together leaders
from all these different social movements around those issues and try to have a discussion, a dialogue about what you mentioned. Where do we go with this? Mm-hmm. How do we organize this in a fashion where people can know what to do, when to do it, and how to be most effective in some sort of a mass movement instead of just showing up on a weekend to protest, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. but have a mission, have a goal, have an understanding of who's doing what and why.
Indeed, that would be wonderful. And we did a trial run on something like that in the spring where we had a teach-in and we brought people from all over the region to meet our students, talk to our students, and share ideas about what would a more equitable society within environmental limits look like. You know, it turns out the university doesn't have money for these things, but I'm happy to talk with anyone who would like to get something like this going, and if we can fund it, we can do it. So I think that's a tremendous idea. Yes?
I'd just like to follow up on the comments about the protest, because I think a lot of what that does is it makes us feel empowered, and I would say we should never forget in this state and maybe every other state, we have people initiatives. We've already proven in this state on things like gun safety, if we don't get our own legislators to initiate laws, that we put those into our own people initiatives, and we have like 70% of our Washington State voters vote for background checks that we couldn't get any of our legislators to initiate. So there's a power in that. I think we forget about that power, and I think we let people erase that power, and I would just suggest that we remember we have our own people power for our own initiative to be a part of our own democracy.
I agree. Again, choose your initiatives wisely. And really think about, because here's a kind of a capsule version of the last hour and a half. I mean, if representation is so skewed toward one sector of society, let's just say business, and really other areas are under attack, and you can imagine how many of those areas there are, we can end up fighting endless fights that are very fatiguing. And I think that that's the danger that we face, is that there are so many worthy causes that are in such dire straits that we have fragmented the, if you will, the resistance. And what I think is that if we take a breath, step back, and realize that if we step up the level a bit of our thinking about what we want, so that we're not resisting and fighting against, but actively promoting positive ideas, then I think we're in a better position. It feels better, doesn't feel like we're embattled, that we're always fighting the good fight but losing the war. Next week I'll have some things to say about the environmental movement, some recommendations to my friends in the environmental movement about how they could make a big impact if they would shift their thinking a little bit about what they're asking for. Rather than fighting coal trains, fighting pipelines, fighting this, fighting that, and overall, losing. So how can we start winning? That, I think, needs to be our big question for the last couple of lectures in here. So one more question, and then I'm going to say thank you very much.
Hi, I happen to have the good fortune of being taking an economics class at the same time that I'm hearing your lectures.
Great.
So I'm
curious.
How are
they matching up?
Not at all. So the it's
what a surprise.
I know. So I'd be interested to hear from you. When you interact with folks in the economics department, coming back up. One of the things that I've learned is that one of the keys to our economic prosperity, according to economists, is that is institutions. The highly functioning, well-run, transparent institutions. Which seem to be at risk all over the place. And so is there worry in the economic community that would then translate up into worry among elites, among business folks? In other words, is that conversation happening in that universe of people?
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of worried economists. I mean, you can imagine. Last week I talked about Larry Summers having kind of gone from the engineer of the financial deregulation and then the bank bailout from the Clinton administration to the Obama administration, and now suddenly discovers that growth may be over. He calls it secular stagnation, which my son told me is a term of art used by economists for when economies stop cycling, right? So what's non-cyclical? Well, it's like flatlining forever. So if Larry Summers is worried about this, but here's my problem with Larry Summers, same problem I have with Paul Krugman, right? Whom I enjoy reading. He's very entertaining and, you know, very smart. But I don't remember the last time I ever saw Paul Krugman talk about the environment or the limits to growth in any of his columns. It's missing. So the environment is missing in action in the whole mainstream of the field of economics, from the neoliberals to the post-Keynesians like Paul Krugman. So that's, I mean, yes, they're worried, but they're missing a whole lot of things because disciplines put people in silos. Political science is a silo. Sociology is a bigger silo. But economics is a very hardened silo. That's my feeling. I mean, let me know how you're experiencing your economics class. So with that, I say thank you so much and see you next time.